Considering solar to power your heat pump? Whether you're building a new system or adding panels to your existing solar system to cover the load, with or without battery or water tank storage? Stay tuned, we'll cover load and storage as well as what to watch out for. I'm Kata, welcome to my ePoint. I was a bit surprised at how many articles I saw that went something like, can you run a heat pump with solar? Yes, you can run a heat pump with solar. The question is just, how do you make it most economically viable and sustainable? There are four options. Batteries, meaning chemical batteries, typically lithium ion. A water tank, thus heat, thermal storage, outstanding insulation, and finally, the grid backup or power generation. Heat pumps are an incredible investment in your monthly savings and clean energy. I mentioned the importance of insulation and suggested quick fixes and long-term investments in insulation in several videos. Technically, you can use outstanding insulation, like a passive house, to store energy at night that you gain during the day. To power heat pump systems, most of the energy is actually transferred either from the outside air or the ground to the home. The remaining electricity to do so can be provided by solar, with or without local battery storage. Powering your heat pump with solar panels can maximize energy savings while decreasing your carbon footprint. Heat pump technology has evolved to fit various heating and cooling needs. There are cold climate heat pumps and heat pumps from only one room to multiple zones throughout your home. You can combine them with a central ducted system or install ductless mini splits. The variety in the heat pump market is very exciting, however, it can be overwhelming. So how do you estimate your heat pump's electricity usage? At the end of the day, it all comes down to the heating and cooling load, typically measured in British thermal units, BTUs. In cold climates, the capacity of your air source systems, both air-to-air and air-to-water, should match about 99% of your heating and cooling load. Why not 100%? Because typically you don't want your system to cover the two coldest days by far. For those days, your cold climate heat pump has a backup resistor. Ground source heat pumps don't need a backup since there is a steady temperature below about 3 feet or 1 meter underground. So how to estimate the BTUs? Well, if you're replacing an existing furnace, you should have the data. For instance, gas would be your usage in 100 cubic feet, CCF, or cubic meters. Then you convert that to kilowatt hours divided by the efficiency of your heat pump during the second coldest winter days. Now for a new building, you or your HVAC provider can conduct a manual J. There are four main variables to consider when it comes to sizing solar panel needs for your heat pump. Climate zone, volume, so square footage and ceiling height, insulation value, and number of existing windows. There are 10 climate zones in the US ranging from minus 50 degrees Fahrenheit, so minus 46 degrees centigrade, to 40 degrees Fahrenheit, so about 4 degrees centigrade, at the average annual low. To determine the current R value of your home's insulation, you need to know the type and the thickness of the insulation. For instance, fiberglass, the R value is 3 times the thickness in inches. So if you have 10 inches of fiberglass insulation, your R value is 30. If you want to make sure you don't have unnecessary air leaks, you can conduct a blower door test. So much for the load measurement and calculation. Now you know what size of heat pump you need. Passive homes are insulated in a way that it takes days to weeks for them to cool down. Let's assume you have regular insulation and you would like to maximize mid to long-term savings using your own battery storage. There are two types of storage you can use. You can store chemical energy in a battery, typically lithium-ion battery, or you can store thermal energy, so heat, in a water tank. The latter is a solution for air-to-water systems that I highly recommend. It's the most popular system in Germany for new buildings. So how do you get from the size of your heat pump system to the size of the battery bank needed at night? Now, if you want to go completely off-grid, you should have a bit more of a buffer. To properly size it, first decide on the type of the battery. While lead acid are still often considered an option for home battery storage, I highly recommend lithium ion. It's usually the right choice to install lithium ion, given the many advantages of the technology: longer lifetime, higher efficiencies, and higher energy densities. Lithium ion batteries are usually more valuable than lead acid, despite higher upfront costs. Yet another upfront cost versus lifetime cost decision to make. Typically, the governing question for heating and cooling installations, right? Both batteries work by storing a charge and releasing electrons via electrochemical processes. Lithium ion batteries work by discharging positive and negative ions from the material lithium between electrodes. While both lithium ion and lead acid battery options can be effective storage solutions, here is how they stack up when compared head to head in key categories. Lithium ion batteries for homes typically range from 5,000 to 15,000 US dollars and last about 10 to 15 years, while lead acid batteries usually cost $500 to $1,000 upfront and last 3 to 12 years. Lithium ion batteries cover 15 plus kilowatt hours and lead acid 1.5 to 5 kilowatt hours. In most cases, lithium ion battery technology is superior to lead acid due to its reliability and efficiency. However, in cases of small off-grid systems that aren't used regularly, less expensive lead acid battery options can be preferable.
We went with lead acid batteries for our off-grid solar setup for a couple different reasons. Number one, heck of a lot cheaper. And also, when you talk to off-grid technicians and electricians, by and large, the consensus is that those haven't actually been out long enough to be put to any kind of a longevity test.
So say you are decided to install lithium ion. Which one should you buy? Beware that I expect this still to change a bit. I think there will be incremental changes in price, performance, and availability. And perhaps disruptive solutions like solid-state batteries finally come around. So how do you calculate the battery bank size based on the size of the solar panel system? Standard off-grid sizing calls for 3 days of autonomy, meaning no energy is coming from solar panels or any other sources. And at the end of those 3 days, the battery will be down to 50% state of charge, SOC. In practice, this actually works out more than 3 days of storage, since even on overcast days, solar panels produce power. And we can drain batteries all the way down to 20% SOC without doing damage. Next, we need to figure out what size our battery bank needs to be. To get to the total energy needed in battery storage, we need to multiply that by the number of days of energy storage and divide that by 1 minus the battery SOC that we are willing to go down to. For batteries, it is more convenient to work with amp hours, a somewhat fictive number of the amps we can draw out of the battery for 1 hour before they are empty. Amp hours, AH, is relative to the battery bank voltage, typically 24 or 48 volts, sometimes 12 or 36 volts. For the number of batteries needed, simply divide the total amp hours of your usage by the amp hours of the battery. Now, if you are wondering how many solar panels you need to cover the daily usage, look up your peak sun hours. Your daily watt hours per panel is equal to the average hours of sunlight times the solar panel wattage times 75% maximum power production to account for changing weather conditions, and lower sun intensity in the morning and afternoon, divided by 1000 watts per kilowatt. Take into account brands. I won't advertise for any brands on here right now, but I usually don't buy the best known brand because you pay a price for the brand itself that doesn't bring additional value unless the brand makes you feel somehow better, which for me is not the case. For instance, I bought a 10-year Nissan Leaf and invested the remainder in startups rather than buying a new EV of a more expensive brand. Whatever that could be. Thank you very much for watching. If you like this, give us a thumbs up, subscribe, and see you in the next one.